So if anyone is confused, I'm FirstMark and Chris is FirstRound. FirstRound is an absolutely awesome firm that we like very much, and a terrific group of people. So particularly excited to have you. And you guys have been super active in this space, and we're going to talk about all of this. But I'd love to get started, maybe with a few words on your story, your background.
Sure. Thanks very much, Matt, and thanks for putting this on. You brought a lot of energy to this endeavor, and I've been to a few of the Hardwired NYCs and been impressed in the audience, and I'm excited to be here and tell you a little bit about what we're working on here from First Round's perspective. We are the other first in our title, First Round, here in New York. We're a seed stage venture capital firm. We've been focused exclusively on that for 10 years and investing nationally for those 10 years. We're in San Francisco and Philadelphia, as well as our office. We just moved to 60 Madison, so we're right off of Madison Square Park at 26 and 27. And we have 7 investment professionals and a team that's about twice as big as that that works on our platform in the First Round network that provides value to our community. And we're now starting to share and open up some of that. So you may have seen, or would invite you to try the First Round review. We do weekly, multiple times a week, content of actionable insight from other practitioners that we're, again, another initiative we're trying to share out to the world. And we've now, I'd say we've got about a dozen connected devices, Internet of Things companies. And hopefully we'll get a chance to talk about it. We will talk about a number of them today. That's mathematically, that's about maybe 5 or 6% of our portfolio. We've got about 200 companies in the First Round community, and so we can talk about the lessons we've learned from seeing a broad perspective of that. And personally, I've been in the tech world for 30 years now, and my first
you started at 12.
Huh?
You started at 12.
No, I didn't. I started in 1984 when I graduated college, and I sold computers. And does anyone know what was being sold in 1984? Any of you alive back then? No, a few of you. It was the Macintosh just came out. It was the IBM personal computer, the PC, the XT, starting the AT. The PC Junior came out that holiday. It was funny, I was thinking about that again when my Canary wasn't coming. I pre-ordered my Canary in the crowdfunding exercise, and instead of sending it to me for Christmas, they sent me a little card, a postcard, saying you could put this under your tree, basically, since it wasn't shipping.
Hey, it's the start.
IBM did that with the PC Junior back in 1984 for Christmas, because they couldn't ship those either. So it reminded me of that. But I spent 10 years in the hardware business of PCs, and then I spent about 5 years in the software and services world at places like Oracle, and then I kind of caught the startup bug and the internet bug, and for the last 15 years I've been focused on that. I was part of a couple of startups that failed miserably. I was part of a couple that did well through acquisition. I spent 6 years at eBay after Half.com was acquired, and then I've been investing with First Round for the last 9 years. So the last thing I'll kind of mention is I'm also a bit of a gadget guru and a collector and a user of all this stuff. So I think I have owned most every single wearable, like Fitbit, Nike Fuel, like this is a Microsoft Band, like kind of everything that has been out there. I think Basis is the one I haven't tried, but pretty much everything else.
Yeah, and actually with that sidetracking the conversation, what was your favorite out of curiosity?
It's the one I'm wearing. It's the Microsoft Band, believe it or not. It's kind of bulky and it doesn't look the coolest, but it's the battery lasts really long. It does heart rate. It does notifications very nicely.
It's sort of amazing how Microsoft is just like coming out of nowhere.
They surprise you with cool, like the HoloLens. Yes. Like again, like another thing that I'm interested in now is virtual reality. And so I've got basically every commercially available VR headset or gadget you can buy, from the Oculus DK2 to the Samsung Gear VR to the cardboard stuff to just, you know, Sony announced something. So I like to play with all this stuff and get a firsthand feel for it.
Okay.
So that's a little background.
Okay, awesome. So let's talk about some of the investments you guys have made, and maybe either while you do it or after you do it, use that to sort of backtrack into what you're interested in, the what parts of this market interest you, what your thesis are. And I think we've featured actually here at this event a bunch of your companies already.
Yeah, so I'll bring up the cheat sheet just so I can run through the list of a few, just so you get a sense of where we've invested. So the two that I've presented here, I'm sure of, would be Ringly and Ring, which is formerly known as DoorBot, were two that I think are good stories, and I could share a little bit there. But electric objects.
Yeah, presented here.
Presented here. Sproutling, they did
presented
as well.
Presented here, yep.
Good, it's good coverage so far. Thalmic Labs with the Mayo.
No, but I'd love to have them.
Okay, we can work on that. New Matter with their 3D printer. Planet Labs putting satellites into space. Square with their reader and payment system. Interesting one called Volano Vascular that is in the healthcare space and can draw blood from patients who have IVs already inserted in hospitals and make that a much less painful process. Smart Things, which was acquired by Samsung, they probably presented at some point.
Yes.
Airware does software for unmanned aerial drones. An interesting one that had a very successful launch just the other week was called Eero. Anybody hear about Eero? They're basically trying to be Sonos for Wi-Fi in your home. Their goal is to provide seamless, simple, beautiful Wi-Fi throughout your home. And they did a Kickstarter launch. Actually, it wasn't even Kickstarter. They did it on their own platform, but they sold $1 million in 2 days. So very successful.
All right.
Launch. So that gives you a broad breadth.
Absolutely. So pick two or three, and as examples of what interests you guys as investors.
Yeah. So I'll pick one, Ringly, with Christina Mercando, who is the CEO. And when she came in and I met her, she had this really unique insight of how the two worlds of the tech. You know, the tech world and the fashion world were separate and would never come together. And that these gadgets that the tech world has made for decades, besides making a version in pink, there wasn't really anything being built for women. And she was going to build a connected smart ring device that would also notify you and let you talk to the person across from the table with you and be notified by vibrations and colors on your ring rather than having to have the phone in front of you. And I thought that was brilliant insight. And it was something that if she got right, that neither the tech world could quickly pivot into being really good at fashion. And I didn't think the fashion world would ever, it would take them a long time to come around to figure out how to integrate tech properly. So that was a really good, I love that bet. And they've launched and shipped, and we've learned a lot with them. And it was exciting because they worked out of our office, so we literally got to see everything and how hard it all is and how it all comes together firsthand right in our office.
Okay, so in terms of market segments, I guess within the general hardware or Internet of Things or 3D printing world, what I hate the term, what's hot, what's not, where are you guys looking, what are you guys excited about?
Yeah, well, I think it's, we tend to be opportunistic or generalist investors more than thesis driven, and we invested in New Matter not because we were looking for 3D printer opportunities, but because it came out of Idea Lab, where we have connections, and we like the founding team and the idea of this really low cost, ridiculously much lower cost price point, and that's how we got there. Other investments have been made because of what we've known about a founder. So in the case of what was DoorBot, what is now Ring.com, you know, we worked with Jamie Siminoff on a prior investment and got to know him there. And, you know, in his case, he's, you know, I think it's a very good idea about a connected doorbell. And you can think about all the safety and convenience features of being able to know who's at your front door when you're here or anywhere in the world. But what Jamie brings to the table is he's a force of nature. He's a promoter and a presenter. He went on Shark Tank and did extremely well. He didn't take their money, but he blew them away and got amazing press from it. And, you know, so we've looked for great entrepreneurs with unique insight, I think would be as much of our filter for these things.
Yeah, and what's interesting in terms of the founders, and something that, you know, we think about a lot as well, is that a lot of the people building those new Internet of Things startup often do not have a hardware background. To which extent is that important to you? To which extent do you think that can be addressed through a team?
Yeah, so I would say, so for example, with Christina at Ringly, her software background was a big driver. And some of the mock-ups that she did right out of the gate showing the user experience on the phone and just her design and aesthetic approach was, that stood out more than understanding how good her hardware skills were. I would say that maybe to disagree a little bit with the first presenter, that I think hardware is really hard. I think it's proven across, a dozen investments to take a lot longer and to cost more money than everyone thinks most of the time. And we could probably dig into that a little bit more, but that, you know, that that's, so I think what I observe is that there's a lot of good ways to get help from accelerators and programs and people who've been down the path, but I kind of notice everybody has to make these mistakes for themselves on their own, and they all do it. And, you know, at one point the team has to go to China themselves and spend a month to work everything out because it's not going as they imagine. So I think you need more, but you do need, the hardware, the firmware guy, the person that really, person that really knows how to get the factories and the processes working on the ground where things are being built.
Okay, so you're the founder, you got the team. What if you're an opportunistic investor, what else do you find? I guess if you're a seed investor, traction, especially in hardware, is a harder concept to find.
Yeah. So traction is a tougher metric to come by now, and I think there can be some misleading indicators of ultimate success. And, while I'm very proud that our company Eero sold $1 million, I think it's a very strong number in a couple of days, it only tells you so much. It's really just an indication of demand versus they've won. And a thing we used to call it back in the, 10 or 12 years, whenever TechCrunch was first starting out, maybe it's more like 8 or 9 years ago, and they would put a story up about you, and all of a sudden you'd get 30,000 users signing up. We used to call it the TechCrunch 30,000, and it was this exciting indicator that everyone loved your product. But what you really found is it was this group of people that were early adopters, and it really wasn't necessarily a big indicator of what would happen down the road. Sometimes it was. One of our companies, Mint.com, won a TechCrunch award and got 30,000 users overnight and went on to great success. But it often was a blip and it would stop. And I'm seeing some evidence of success in a crowdfunding hardware campaign that you're still a long way off from, you know, successfully shipping a product.
So I guess last year everybody was saying Kickstarter. If you have like a crazy good Kickstarter campaign, that's awesome. But I guess what you're saying is that now people are learning that actually it might not be that good an indicator, right? Is that?
Yeah, it's a very good data point. It's certainly better than having a having an unsuccessful one. But there's so much more to it beyond that that. You know, that's not, I'm looking for more than just that.
Okay, so a little bit to the Kickstarter question. So it fundraising was a process that was never simple, but at least the steps in fundraising were relatively well understood. You had a seed round, and then you had a Series A round, especially for hardware, then it's somewhat mind-boggling, right? So you got and complicated. You have, so you can decide to go to an incubator or not. You can decide to do a Kickstarter or Indiegogo crowdfunding campaign or not. You can do a seed. You can do an A. You can get venture debt. Any sort of lessons or anything that you like or any paths that you see working well?
I would say this category of company has seen really no one path. There's so many different options and combinations of how people approach it. And I think that they also don't necessarily come in any logical order, like with a traditional software company that you might see. In fact, like today, did anybody else order the new Pebble time watch? Anybody else here?
So, I read about it, didn't.
So I did, and apparently other folks and myself bought $6 million worth of the watch today. And this is for a company that had previously done a $10 million pre-launch. You know, they were the big story, the first big big breakthrough there. And then funding, and they're sort of grown up, and it's interesting to think of them going back to crowdfunding, very efficient way. Like I don't even know when it's shipping. I don't know exactly what it does, but I've got one coming, mm-hmm. and a lot of people are, you know. So I think that becomes not just a way to start, but as they're showing, it's a way to relaunch product.
Yeah, it's amazing. You need to build a crazy brand to be able to do that, right?
Like, yeah, that's a pretty unique thing. But yeah. I think other, you know, sometimes there's, you know, if the founder's got enough of a background or history or a reputation that you can just raise your Series A out of the gate. We weren't smart enough to back Twitter, but we were smart enough to back Jack Dorsey when he did Square, and he, you know, had no challenges raising his Series A. And then you're seeing a lot in the middle, and I think it's shifting. I think you're seeing venture debt is as widely and wildly available as I think it's ever been. So that's, you know, anytime someone's getting venture funding, that's very often what they're adding on to that round, often to get them through a second pass at the target. Like if everything did, like you may have raised enough in your seed round just to get to launch. And if you find any delays or issues, sometimes the venture debt's been helpful to give them another pass before going out for the full Series A.
Okay, so specifically for some of the people here who are building companies. So the thing of incubators, from your perspective, does that make companies more fundable, less fundable, doesn't matter?
Yes, I think the incubators, things like Highway 1 or Techstars RGA, like those are things that we pay attention to and we go to, and we've seen, you know, I think the companies that come out of them are, you know, much better prepared than they would have been on their own or otherwise. And it's interesting to be able to marry, I think in the case of, you know, of Techstars, you know, design skills that you just wouldn't get anywhere else. And in the case of, like Highway 1 with, you know, manufacturing and scaling capabilities, and people like Dragon, you know, that can help you. So there's really a lot of great resources that add a lot of value beyond just the dollars or, you know, mentoring that they give.
Okay. So if I'm an entrepreneur and I'm starting this, the question that you know you get fairly often is how much should I raise? And all of this has been completely changing over the last year as well. Any thoughts on, you know, I guess what's a seed, what's a Series A, what are appropriate round sizes?
I think the generic answer I've always given that I still believe is true here is you should raise more than you think you need and do it from people that you really want to work with in good times and bad. But in terms of the dollar sizes, I've seen it shift all the way around. I mean, you know, I'd say Ringly was probably a more traditional. I think the seed round was something in the, you know, in the $1 million range, and then the Series A that they just did with Andreessen Horowitz was, you know, more in the traditional side. But I've seen, you know, the wild card in a lot of this is what's the crowdfunding or the pre-sales element of what you have. And I think a lot of people are adding, you know, taking events of funding or pre-sales, and they're using that to very often add on venture debt as a way of financing the company.
But so you the dollars and then changes. You do a Kickstarter, you raise money, you have money through your Kickstarter, you leverage that to get venture. And so I guess how much does it take to build a startup, a hardware startup, all the way to being able to ship these days?
I'm not sure of...
I guess it depends.
Yeah, I guess it depends. I think I've seen it work, you know, in scales from very few to very many single digits of millions.
Yeah, never easy. Okay, so let's wrap up by focusing a couple of questions on stuff that you've seen work and stuff that you see not work in your company. So let's maybe do this in two parts. The first part would be on the sort of production, manufacturing, yeah, design side. Lessons learned.
So on the production, manufacturing, design side, I'd say that, you know, again, to the hardware is hard. I've seen, let's just take the other way, on software, rarely does a company fail in the software business because it could not be built. Like, it wasn't technically possible to build it, or certainly when we're making an investment decision, that's generally not one of the big concerns. And I think that becomes a very real concern on the hardware side, that, like, you know, does it stand up to real customer use? Does it work well enough? Is the Bluetooth connecting? And, you know, you learn a lot of things the hard way. And again, just generally saying that I've seen, you know, more often than not, these things, that element of it, you know, takes longer than you think, and is much more complicated. So expect that to be harder, take longer than you think is what I would say on that side.
Okay. And any lessons learned on the distribution, marketing, retail aspect? I guess retail is one of those under sort of covered area that people don't really think deep enough until sort of when the time comes to, oh shit, we need to go in retail.
Yeah, so something I'd say I've observed is many startups think they don't want to do anything through retail and want to build their own brand on their own, selling direct, which can make sense and is often absolutely the best way to launch. But I think many of them find that they want to take advantage of the benefits of retail channels and partners, and, you know, look and I would encourage startups to think about that, bake that into your early plans, because I think most companies do end up going there. So to build those relationships, to understand the margins required and just the positives and negatives and of working through channels earlier than later, I think is a good idea.
Okay, very cool. Do we have questions? One over there.
Hello. Oh, yeah. So when you say hardware smart, are there some, what are the top three areas where you feel that people underestimate? So in other words, if you want to plan a startup and you want to try to budget, how much money you're going to need and where you need to put the time, what are the top three where people really mess up at? Or is it just a top three that where you need time?
I don't know that I'm deep enough to give you the, you know, a much more detailed level, but I'll say, for example, Wi-Fi radios don't work, you know, in real life like you think they do, you know, theoretically, or Bluetooth connections don't stay, you know, connected the way you think so, or the yields that you might expect to get out of your production runs might be markedly lower and different than 100%. And so I think that taking those kind of, those are things I've seen personally that have added up to delays and increased costs.
So they're going to China asking, somebody told me that they're going to get the details spec in the next 2 months. And if you don't get the spec
right, then I've never been to China. The question was should you give, in dealing with China, give them a detailed spec? And does that help? I've never been, and I've never given a Chinese manufacturer a spec personally, but my sense is you get a lot of people saying how easy it is and how great it's going to be, and then in reality everybody has an issue and has to go there themselves to fix it. So I would maybe say invest the time and go earlier than you think you need to.
So you guys started off the conversation, I think one of the questions Matt asked was some of your favorite companies that are connected devices or things, I don't remember what it was, but I thought that what was really interesting about your answer was that the companies that you picked were so vastly different. You had Square, which is, it has a hardware piece, but that kind of was interesting for me to even think about it as a hardware company. Airware, which is offering super drones, and you know, Lasco Vascular, which is, you know, most people think of as a healthcare company. Do you think that, and I know on your website, I'm sure enough, you have like a hardware section and you actually put all that stuff together so you're consistent, but do you think that it really is hardware, like, as a category, that these companies are all working together, or is it just sort of the other group that you have to put under? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, we've got a lot of other investments in physical things, like just right here in New York. I'm point on our investment in Warby Parker, Chloe and Isabel Poppin. Like, these are all companies that have their own manufacturing. I think what we're keeping to the theme of tonight, it's more about the new wave of connected devices, Internet of Things, wearables. I think so. Maybe Volano doesn't really fit into that bucket, maybe you could rephrase.
What does a payment reader have in common with an operating system for a drone?
They're both hardware. Well, they're hardware. They're connected hardware devices. And, you know, that are enabling new capabilities, and they fit into the theme of tonight's talk. But it's quite a range of things. Yes.
In terms of industries and trends, what industries do you think and applications of connected devices are overhyped, and what applications are completely obscure and underhyped?
Well, I don't know. Let me think. I'll tell you what I think virtual reality is an example of both. I think it's wildly hyped, but I think people are underestimating, or many people are underestimating, where it ultimately goes. I think, you know, the Fitbit, Nike world is very crowded, and maybe that's a little overinvested. I think, you know, it'll be interesting to see if watches are they could possibly be overhyped. You know, that may end up not delivering what people expect at the end of the day, I think. But what I get really excited about, if you think about products that have, you know, really changed markets and lives, like, to me, Sonos is a great example of, you know, like someone before talked about Crestron. I used to have Crestron devices in my houses, and they didn't work. And now I have, you know, Sonos just works beautifully, and it works so well. I wish it could go into my car, and I could just, and it was my interface on my phone. I would use it everywhere if I could, and that's been bigger than I think anybody imagined it might be. I think Apple should have bought Sonos instead of Beats. That would have been a much more interesting acquisition. I think Nest was beamed from the future, it feels like. That was the most amazing product. And I think people bought it because it was cool and fun, and now it's actually saving energy. It pays for itself, you know, for what you bought it for. So I think there's a couple categories that I would say are pretty exciting.
All right, terrific. Well, that's all the time we have. But thank you very much. I'm very happy that you're able to make it. Thank you.
Thanks, Ben.